Thank you to welcome me. I'm Christophe Regoubi, part of a data transformation team in Airbus, and specifically in the advanced analytic team. I'm proud to present you a very short oversight of our path to machine learning maturity. So for the one that doesn't know Airbus, Airbus is a big aircraft manufacturer, having a big premises here in Toulouse. We exist till 50 years. We celebrate our 15th anniversary this year. We have delivered 12,000 aircraft around the world since the beginning. Our latest aircraft is the Beluga XL, so you have a chance maybe to see it in the sky of Toulouse this week. Airbus is made by three different entities: Airbus Defence and Space, helicopters, and civil aircrafts. That's the general presentation. I will now go into what we do with data. So first, in order to work with data and modeling, we need a data lake. So we built a data lake 2 years ago. It is called SkyWise. And it intends to gather all aircraft-related data from the engineering of the aircraft down to the whole operation life cycle of the aircraft. A lot of data comes from Airbus in the process of engineering, designing, and manufacturing the aircraft. And then, during its whole life cycle, the aircraft is selling data to SkyWise. So two big components. I will not go into the detail, but data is secured in four different environments: the Airbus one, the airline one, the supplier one, and the aircraft, which is shared for all of them. And from that big black data lake, which is basically a Spark environment, we have a lot of self-service. So where people come and self-service on the data, do their analysis, do their small visualization application. The data lake, of course, hosts applications and API, and that's where we put the famous Sparklier library. On top of this data lake, which is the fundamental brick for data analysis and machine learning, we have that, the team I'm part of, which is Advanced Analytics. Those are the big numbers, but I want to emphasize that the organization level, this is a central team, so half of the data scientists are in my team. Another, almost the other half is in a research area. And it's a central team, but we make a lot of projects in spreading our team into the business. And our goal is not to be central and not to keep central, but to spread the knowledge of data analysis and that machine learning and data science is a tool that everyone in the company should be able to work with in his own tool set, even if it's a business related job he has. And that's the reason why we train through a specific program analysts that comes from the business functions inside Airbus, and at that training and ends being a data analyst with a certificate, having worked on specific data analysis project in Airbus. And we have currently 400 of those people, and two additional ones, 200 are currently on the training additionally. And we have also organized three AI challenge. I will talk a little bit later on. I really want to say the one characteristic of our team, it's spread on four different countries. So right now, India, Hamburg in Germany, and Toulouse in France. We will open in fall the Filton in UK location, and soon the Getafe in Spain location. It's a very diverse and very terribly international team, I would say. people in part of the 22 people comes from four different continents. So it's a truly international environment to work with. What do we do? We work for very diverse business entity within Airbus, and what we do with those business data is right now mainly knowledge extraction and advanced optimization. And I will talk about two examples of those typical project, two specific ones we have moved to production in using R code and pipelines. The first one is called the main landing gear door rigging. So we have a specific thing to do in Airbus when we build the aircraft is rigging the main landing gear. So you can see the main landing gear open here and close here, and it has to be really tightly adjusted to the aircraft for the sound it produces and for the effort that exists on this door by hydraulic actuator being more than 2 tons. So it has to be adjusted very tightly to the bezel. And the door itself comes from one plant, and the plant produces the door plus produce an adjustment paper with the different adjustment needed to match the specification. And the bezel, where the doors comes, is done by another supplier. Everything is brought back to Toulouse, where the assembly occurs, and there is that adjustment to be made on 7 different parameter, being seams, value, gaps, and steps. So from multiple measurement along the door, there must be adjustment in order to the door to perfectly fit, as you can see on the video. So this has been done according to Chinese application that collects the Excel sheet from one plant, so with a read Excel package, PDF files from the supplier of the door according to read PDF, no, PDF tools, and everything is done together, move to a Python machine learning package, a machine learning interface for Reticulate. So thanks for Reticulate. And a lot of different things put together. Right now it's on production, and it allows really to gain time on that rigging effort that has to be made on each aircraft. Second project I want to talk about is completely different. This is really knowledge extraction. So in Airbus, we are very careful with regulation, and specifically GDPR regulation. As I mentioned earlier, a lot of data sets are released for people to work directly on. So it's a self-service data set available. So from a lot of data sets in Airbus, there are PII information. So publicly identifying information, and we decide in order to fulfill the GDPR compliance to make a privacy by design, meaning we removed all the PII information from the data. The free text data sets in Airbus are used in a lot of the manufacturing workflow, because that's the way for people to exchange problems, difficulties, whatever they have together in between team. It's all managed by the ERP system. So as you can see, the ERP system put a header, which is almost structured, and then after that it's the free text. Of course, it's international, so you mixed language in the same document. It's not real natural language processing, because it's not natural at all. It's Airbus English engineering. And what else? Yeah, PII information include user IDs. User IDs is never to be found in any pre-trained model for NLP. So we did that through Core NLP package, which is a wrapper for Core NLP. Anyway, Quantida package, which is a very effective package for large corpus mining. I can't remember the list of the other package, but thanks to R and the NLP ecosystem, we succeed in putting that data set, in removing all the PII values for any people to work with with the rest of the text mining. Another thing I want to present you is the AI challenge. So for some very hard problem we have, we were not able to solve it internally, and we questioned the community about what is the real state of the art in solving such problems. And for the AI part of the team, which is composed of five pillars, we released three challenges, one for knowledge extraction, the other one for conversational assistance and anomaly detection. And we put that, we host a website with the challenge, so it's Kaggle-like. And the good news is that there is a good understanding of those problems with a lot of team, more and more team participating to the challenge. So for the latest challenge, which is a time series anomaly detection in a semi-supervised or unsupervised way, we had 200 people signing in to the challenge and 38 team answering. And I just want to close that with some data allowing you to understand the difficulty we may have in our industry. So the speech recognition challenge is made for pilot to air traffic control communication. So the communication is very compressed because the communication channel is very low bit rate. And I would want you just to.
Falcon 5000 feet, 1031, maintaining ground contact, DC 787. Thank you, sir.
So that's the example of what you hear. And the challenge is about speak to text from that. So the data set is bigger, but anyway, that's one tough example. And if we use publicly available API for speak to text, you can see what the Google speech goes and what the Airbus research team has been able to get. So you can see those are very specific problems to the industry, but very challenging. That's one of those. And the second we add is time series anomaly detection. So we release a data set of 350 flights with a lot of data that was available for you to understand the size of the problem we have with such a data set. That's it for me. Thank you very much.
Bonjour Toulouse, Marthold et moi, on est honorés de pouvoir vous présenter notre entreprise OpenAnalytics en 5 petites minutes.
Bonjour, don't panic, we're not going to do everything in French. So OpenAnalytics is an international consulting company based in Antwerp, and we traveled to Toulouse with a small delegation of our company. You might have missed some talks earlier today, but there's still some upcoming tomorrow and on Friday. Yeah, they're listed here, but you can also find them in the program. It nicely illustrates some case studies we have been working on recently on the four pillars that we provide to our clients: statistical consulting, scientific programming, application development, and hardware and hosting.
So you may have heard of our company if you attended the Docker tutorial yesterday afternoon, how to use this technology for R and especially to deploy Shiny application with Shiny proxy. So as Martel mentioned, we are a team of currently 30 people, and there is a small delegation here, but the other colleagues that you can see on the picture here are still working in Antwerp. And we are actually a team quite diverse in terms of nationality and also background. So we have computer scientists, mathematicians, statisticians, and engineers. And our service can be grouped into four different pillars. So the first one is the main one, statistical consulting. So we can provide support to find the optimal statistical methodology for your own problem. Then we try to implement this methodology. So we are actually a great fan of the R language, and we also try to promote R within our clients. It's in an enterprise context.
And then the third pillar, it mainly implements the first two ones in a more user-friendly way. For example, Shiny applications are a nice way of integration into a company service. And then the last pillar, it's a bit apart from the three previous ones. It's about hosting, which can be on our own servers, the client servers, or in the cloud, as the client wishes. These resulted in multiple open source R packages and open source products. So some of these R packages are on CRAN, Bioconductor, or our own repository, but many more are available on the infrastructure of our clients.
We also have a set of open source products that you can see here in the visualization. So the first top four on the top of the circle are all based on the Docker technology. So you have RShiny RBase, which are Docker images to deploy R and R with Shiny within Docker container. There is Shiny proxy, so the most, I think, famous one, which is based on the container proxy technology. And we also have a set of four other Java tools: Architect, RServiceBus, RDepot, and Fedra, that Martel will describe in the next slide. Maybe something also that we should mention is that all these products are fully open source, in the sense that the code is available in the GitHub of our company, so you can have a look and submit some update if you like.
So we have RDepot, which is mainly a tool to manage R packages, repositories in an enterprise. Also, R Service Bus is nice for job automation with R. It can be seen a bit as the ancestor of our Shiny proxy, which is a tool to deploy in Shiny applications for large companies based on the Docker technology.
We also have an IDE for R, which is called Architect, which is actually a plugin based on the open source Eclipse project. So the main advantage that with this framework, you can actually use all the different plugins which are available within this project, for example, to also use Python or other programming languages to connect to databases, etc. And the last one quickly, so it's Fedra. It's a tool that we recently open source. It's actually a platform to capture data and analyze data from high content screening imaging, as you can see here.
So for now, we want to thank you for your attention. And we welcome you at our booth at the ground floor to get your hack stickers and play petanque, as you may have heard of. But also, of course, to talk about job openings and our services.
Okay. Merci.
Thank you to the sponsors. Welcome to the plenary session again. So for the last keynote of the day, so I have to remind you that we're using Slido for the question and answer sessions. So our next speaker is my former art teacher when I was in grad school. So she taught me my first art commands back in 2006. And well, now I run a company based on our services, so I let you draw your own conclusions. So she is especially a core team member and conference team leader of R Forward, the R Foundation Task Force on Women and Underrepresented Groups. And she, and last but not least, she's a teacher at Polytechnique. Her field is missing data, and this is the topic of this keynote. Please warmly welcome Julie Joss.
So thank you very much, Diane, for the kind introduction. So first, I want to warmly thank the organizer and the scientific committee because I know the work that this represents. Indeed, we organized users in Rennes in 2009, and back at that time, there were less than 500 participants. So I am really thrilled today to see this vibrant community. It is also at that time that Toby Hawkins, an active member of the community, had offered me this poster. Maybe he is in the room. And I use this poster since for all my talks. So this is an opportunity for me to thank you. So yes, I was already working on missing values. And so the purpose of my talk today is really to share my 10 years of experience, but also to present you a recent contribution on supervised learning with missing values, because I am really excited about this work. So I have many collaborators on the subject, and I am also very lucky to have amazing students. So I want in particular to mention François Husson, who is one of my main collaborators, and with whom I developed the R package MissMDA, which is dedicated to performing principal component methods with missing values and to impute data. I have also different fields of applications, and although there may be a huge bias because it's one of my research specialties, each time when I analyze data from any fields, they always have missing values. So these days, my research is motivated by an ongoing collaboration with Paris Hospital and with a trauma-based group, which is dedicated to the management of polytraumatized patients. So we have at our disposal a database which has currently more than 20,000 patients, which are described by 250 variables that can be quantitative, such as blood pressure, lactate, or categorical, such as the kind of accidents. And the data is very detailed because for each patient, I have at disposal data collected from the site of the accident where the patient is taken in charge by the ambulance from his discharge to the hospital. So associated to this data, there are many challenges. So some are causal. So for instance, we would like to assess the impact of an intervention, such as the administration of a treatment, on an outcome, such as survival. Given the fact that we have observational data, it means potentially confounded by selection bias due to the absence of randomization. So I am currently working a lot on these issues. Other challenges are predictive, which will be the aim of my presentation today. So for instance, given pre-hospital features, so it means patient characteristics, I would like to predict the risk of having an hemorrhagic shock. So from a statistical point of view, it boils down to performing predictive models, such as random forest or logistic regression, which covariates that can be quantitative or categorical. But the establishment of even simple models is made complicated by the fact that there are many missing values. So here I presented a bar plot of the percentage of missing values for a subset of 45 variables. And you can see that it varies a lot. So from nearly zero for certain variables to 100%. And in addition, there are different codes for the missing values. So in my data, you can see that I have NM, NA, NR. So for instance, NAIM, if it is for measure not made, so it simply indicates that the team has forgotten to fill out the form. But sometimes I have also informative missing values, like impossible. So it means that the state of my patient is such that it is impossible to make the measurement. In addition, the problem of missing values is exacerbated with the amount of different sources of information, because it was not necessarily planned to analyze this data together at the beginning. Here, I have data from 11 different hospitals, and consequently, I can have what is called systematic missing values. It means that it is one feature which is not observed in one hospital. So if I want to perform my logistic regression in R, for instance, using the GLM function, by default, the method to manage the missing values consists in deleting the observation with missing values. Indeed, the argument na.action, so na it is for not available, is set to na.omit. So this approach can be satisfying if you have only few missing values completely at random. But it can lead to the deletion of almost all your data. So to illustrate this point, let's consider a matrix with n rows and p variables, where each entry is missing independently with probability equal to 0.01. When p is equal to 5, the complete case analysis would result in around 95% of the observation being kept. But even when p is equal to 300, only around 5% of the observations will have no missing entries. So consequently, it is not possible to use this strategy in practice. And in addition, it may also lead to the deletion of a subpopulation, which will lead to bias in your estimate. So even though if I will not dwell on this during this talk, the first things to do when you have missing values is to do, as for any analysis, descriptive statistics to explore and visualize the missing values. So the idea is to get information about the pattern, but also to question the reasons for their occurrence. And in R, there are different packages for this task, such as Vim, Nanyar, and also Factominer. So for instance, we can represent a biplot to study the distribution of observed and missing values, but we can also represent a plot to study the association between observed and missing variables from a multidimensional point of view. So here, I created a plot with Factominer, which reads as follows. So if PAS missing is close to PID missing, it means that often when I have missing values on the systolic blood pressure, I also have missing values on the diastolic blood pressure. And in fact, this is okay. There is nothing to report because these two variables are often collected together. However, the proximities between these variables highlight a different issue, which is not really an issue of missing values, but rather an issue of coding. Indeed, there is an exam which is done for the patients to see if the pupils are normal or not. If their pupils are normal, then there are other tests and treatments that are given if they are not normal. If they are normal, then nothing is done. And consequently, in the data, it was coded missing. And in fact, it is not really missing in the sense that I will not use the classical tools to handle missing values, but I will rather recode my data. So in the first part of the talk, I will present the available methods to handle missing values and the available packages. So in other words, to perform my logistic regression with missing values. And then, In the second part, we will focus on supervised learning with missing values. So there are two main strategies available to deal with missing values. So the first one consists in modifying your estimation process so that it can be applied on an incomplete data set. So for instance, we can use an expectation maximization algorithm to get the maximum likelihood estimate despite missing values, and other algorithms such as supplemented EM or Lewis formulae to get their variability. So I will manage to estimate my beta parameters of my logistic regression and their variance. So this approach is perfectly well-fitted toward your specific aim. In other words, it's difficult to do better, but it has some drawbacks. So first, as we will see later, it's not necessarily easy to design an EM algorithm, even for simple models. And consequently, there are not so many implementations. But the main drawback is that you need to design a specific algorithm for each statistical method, machine learning algorithm, that you want to apply. So if on your data set you want to do a regression, you need to find a way to modify the process so that you can do your regression with missing values. But often, before doing a regression, you will explore the data, for instance, using a dimensionality reduction method, such as PCA. So consequently, you need also to have a method that do the PCA despite the missing values. And if you want to do an unsupervised clustering algorithm as well, same thing, you need to modify your algorithm. And often, on a data set, we do many different analyses. So that's why the second approach is much more popular. So it consists in imputation. So it means that we are going to replace the missing entries with plausible values to get a complete data set that can be analyzed by any statistical or machine learning algorithm. So what is important to note here is that even if I impute the data, my aim is not to impute and predict as well as possible the missing entries, but my aim is really to estimate as well as possible the parameters and their variance from the incomplete data set. In other words, to get my beta and the variance of the beta parameters. So the most popular imputation method is the imputation with the mean, but it is known to have several drawbacks. So I will illustrate these drawbacks using a toy example. So by generating a bivariate data set drawn from a Gaussian distribution with a positive structure of correlation between the two variables. So there is a correlation coefficient equal to 0.6. Then I introduce 70% of missing entries completely at random on Y. So here you can see the red points. And I impute the missing values with the mean of the observed values. So imputed values are in red. And on this data set, which is now complete, I can do statistics, so I can estimate some parameters. So here, I will estimate the mean, the standard deviation, and the correlation coefficient. So the mean is perfectly preserved, which makes sense. However, the variance is too small because we have imputed all the missing entries with the same quantity. So there is less variability in this imputed data set in comparison to the original data set. And the estimated correlation coefficient is biased downward because the true population value was equal to 0.6, which makes sense as well. So we completely destroy the correlation between the variables. So that's why we say that mean imputation deforms joint and marginal distributions. So of course, this is just a toy data set with two variables. But the consequences of such an approach can be dramatic for a real data. So here, I have a data set with 70,000 species of plants described by 6 ecological traits. And there are many missing values because, in fact, it was the aggregation of data coming from different countries. So on the top, I represented the PCA plots obtained after imputing the missing entries by Zermin. On the bottom, I represented an optimal EM PCA that skipped the missing entries. And you can see that both representations are very different. So I don't know if you are used to reading this plot, but basically, the angle between two arrows represents the estimated correlation. So on the top, I can see that P-mass and R-mass are orthogonal, so it means that the estimated correlation is equal to zero, whereas on the bottom, the two arrows are collinear, so it means that the estimated correlation is equal to one. So this is completely different, and it leads to completely different interpretation. And the ecologist favors the interpretation of the bottom. So that's why I have spent the past 10 years saying to all my students and to anyone during lecture on missing values and tutorials that mean imputation is really the worst thing that you can do. And if you have only one thing to keep from my lecture, is please do not impute by the mean. But in fact, it turns out, as we will see later, that this is true when your aim is to estimate as well as possible parameters, but when your aim is to do prediction, this is not necessarily the case. So fortunately, there are other imputation methods that preserve the joint and marginal distribution of your data. So if you are willing to make a Gaussian assumption of the data, you can impute the missing values by drawing from the conditional distribution of the missing values given observed values and estimated parameters. So in other words, you can impute by stochastic regression, so which consists in adding to the imputation on the regression line a noise with variance equal to the residual's variance. So on this plot here, we can see that the imputed values in red looks like the observed values in black. So we have apparently solved the problem of missing values. And if we estimate some quantities on the data completed by stochastic regression, we can have an unbiased estimate for the mean, but also for the standard deviation and for the correlation coefficient. So this is also the case of a toy data set with a bivariate data and only missing values in one variable. But this approach can be easily extended for multivariate data, so with many variables and missing values everywhere. So the extension of this imputation by stochastic regression consists in assuming a joint Gaussian distribution from your data. And this is the approach which is implemented in the package Amelia. And it turns out that there are a bunch of other imputation methods which are available. So some powerful ones impute by considering that the data can be generated as a Lorentz structure corrupted by noise. And there are other interesting and recent suggestions based on variational autoencoders. So there is another family of imputation methods, which also impute by drawing from a joint distribution, but which is not explicit, but implicitly defined through a set of conditional distributions. So this is what is implemented in the famous R package MICE by Stefan Van Buren. There are also methods to impute variables with categorical variables, mixed variables, when your data are structured with blocks of variables or with a multi-level structure. So it means that you have, for instance, patients nested within hospitals. And it turns out that there are more than 150 packages dedicated to this task. So that's why we have decided with Nick Tierney and Nathalie Villa, who is the main organizer of this conference, to create a missing values task view. So to list all the packages, but also to organize them by topics and to explain what they do. So today, I will not speak about the advantages and drawbacks about all these methods, but of course, we can speak about it after, but I will just focus on a few points. So the first thing which is important for me is to remember that when you impute a data set, you impute according to an imputation model, which is implicit or explicit. And consequently, the properties of your imputation will derive from the properties of the imputation method. So to illustrate this point, let's consider an example with a matrix of the type of Netflix. So I have consumers, people as rows, and movies as columns. And each cell of the data matrix corresponds to the score given by a consumer for a movie. So here, the variables are duplicated, highly correlated. The correlation is equal to 1. And then I introduced missing values for the variable 2 and variable 3 when the values of the variable 1 are larger than 7. So this is called missing at random in the missing value literature because the missing values depend on observed values. Then I imputed using the missForest function of the missForest package and using the imputePCA function of the missMDA package. And you can see that both imputations differ. So in this apparent easy case, the imputation with forest is not able to recover the underlying values, whereas the imputation with PCA, it is possible to extrapolate. So I do not say that extrapolating is good or bad. The point is that just it makes sense. It makes sense because when you impute with random forest, basically you impute using nearest neighbor imputation. So it means that you will compute the average of nearest neighbor observation. So you will stay within the range of your data. Whereas where you impute with PCA, it is based on linear relationship, so you can extrapolate. So basically, random forest imputation will be appropriate like random forest, so when you have non-linear relationship and interaction between variables, and PCA will be appropriate when you have linear relationships. So this is the first point. Second point is that when you have an incomplete data set, like my throwback base, you give it to me, and I will output a completed data set. So no matter what, I can use any imputation methods and I will always output an imputed data set. So what confidence can be given to the analysis performed on this imputed data set, which was at the beginning incomplete? Because we have a tendency to forget that in this imputed data set, I have observed values in black, but also imputed values in blue. And these imputed values are predicted using an imputation prediction models. So consequently, there is an uncertainty associated to this prediction. And single imputation and a single value cannot reflect the uncertainty of prediction. So that's why it is very important to go to multiple imputation. So multiple imputation consists first in generating different plausible values for each missing entries. So it leads to here M imputed data sets. And the variability among the different imputed values reflects the variance of prediction with which the missing values are predicted using the observed values and the imputation model. So it really reflects the variance of prediction. So here I have predicted 4, but maybe it can be 12 or it can be minus 5. Okay? And these techniques of multiple imputation are implemented in many packages, such as the package MICE. So at this stage, when you have done multiple imputation, it's also crucial to visualize the variability of prediction. So here, I presented a PCA plot to represent the variability between the different imputed values. So you can see that this point, 6, does not have missing entries, whereas the point, 5, has missing values. And this ellipse represents the variability of the position of these points with different imputed values, because it can be 4, it can be 15, or 10, or 20. And this graph helps me, in fact, because I can see that even with different predicted values, the position of this 0.5, it is still on the right of my plot. So consequently, the interpretation will be the same. The interpretation is not harmed by the missing entries. So in addition, this plot helped me to know if I need to stop the analysis or if I can continue. Because you know, the variability is too large, it's better to stop rather than continuing doing any analysis. Finally, this is very useful also to answer this famous question about the percentage of missing entries. Because often users ask me, OK, I have a data set and I have 40% of missing entries. Is it OK? Is it too much? Or if, I don't know, 20, is it OK? 45, and so on. So what is really important is that it is not only the percentage of missing entries that matter, but it is both the percentage and the structure of your data. So imagine a data set where all the variables are duplicated, highly correlated. Even with 90% of missing entries, I will be able to predict very accurately the missing values. And consequently, the variance of prediction will be very small. And consequently, the ellipses will be very small. So I can proceed. This is OK. But if I have a data set which is at the beginning not well structured, so the variables are not well related, even a small percentage of missing values can completely destroy my analysis. And so the variance of prediction will be very large, and the ellipses very large. So that's why I can be, these plots can help me. So after this step of visualization, multiple imputation consists in performing the statistical analysis on each imputed data set. So in other words, I perform my logistic regression on each imputed data set. And then I combine the results using Rubin's rule to get point estimates, but also estimation of the variance that takes into account the fact that I had missing values. The supplement variability due to missing values is taken into account because we have two parts, the mean of the within variance, and this is the between variability, so it is the variability of the estimates due to the fact that we have different plausible values. So we are done for the first part. So it means that to do my logistic regression with missing values, I can use some packages such as MICE and then apply my logistic regression on each imputed data set. So this is the first strategy. So I will briefly describe the second strategy to do logistic regression with missing values, which consists in using an EM algorithm, just to show you that it's not necessarily straightforward, and also because we will use it after. So I have my matrix X of covariates with n observations and d variables, and the vector Y of binary responses with hemorrhagic shock and not hemorrhagic shock. So I consider the classical logistic regression model, where I model the probability of having an hemorrhagic shock with exponential of x beta divided by 1 plus exponential of x beta. Then, with missing values, I need to assume a probabilistic framework, and consequently to assume that my covariates follow a Gaussian distribution. So consequently, even if my aim is to estimate as well as possible my beta parameters, I will have nuisance parameters with the vector of means and the covariance matrix of the covariates. So the likelihood has consequently two parts, the classical one with the distribution of y given covariates, and the one associated with the distribution of the covariates. So then we have missing values. And within the likelihood framework, in fact, it turns out that the underlying assumptions about the missing value mechanism are often more explicit. So I will denote a matrix M with Mij equal to zero when my observation Xij is observed, and equal to one otherwise. So what is important is that when you have missing values, in fact, you have two data generating processes, two random processes. The one which generates the classical data, here denoted by P theta, and the one which generates the missing values, which is called the missing value mechanism. So this is the distribution of the missing values given the data. And the classical missing at random assumption for this mechanism implies that the missing values depends only on observed values. So the classical example being the one with two variables, income and age, and you have missing values on income. So missing at random means that the probability to have missing values on income only depends on the age. So in other words, you can say that maybe older people are less inclined to reveal their income. Missing non at random would be the case where the probability to have missing values on income depends only on income, so maybe rich people are less inclined to reveal their income. By doing this assumption, we can, when we do the inference on the parameter theta with missing values, it turns out that we can ignore the missing value mechanism when we do the inference. And so consequently, we can maximize the observed likelihood, which is obtained by integrating over the missing entries, and we can completely ignore this mechanism. However, it turns out that we do not have an explicit form often to maximize this observed likelihood, and that's why we use EM expectation maximization algorithm, where we will iterate two steps, one step to compute the conditional expectation of the complete classical likelihood with respect to the distribution of missing values given observed values and parameters. And in the M step, we will maximize these quantities. But it turns out that, for instance, for the logistic regression model, same thing, you do not have an explicit form for this E step. So consequently, one solution is to use methods like Monte Carlo EM, where you will generate samples from the distribution of missing values given observed values and parameters, and you will approximate the integral by empirical means. But this can be computationally heavy. So that's why, with colleagues, we implemented a stochastic approximation EM, so which is implemented in the package MIS-AEM, and so at the end, we managed to estimate the beta parameters and their variance from the incomplete data set. So it means that we get the MLE with missing values, and we have good coverage properties. So it means that we are able to appropriately take into account the supplement variability, which is due to the missing values. So it seems that I am apparently kind of done. So I have my trauma-based data. The doctors ask me, okay, we need to design a model to predict the risk of hemorrhagic shock. I have missing values. I make some assumptions, but I can use either mice or do imputation or my EM algorithm. So I am apparently, I have solved my problem. But it turns out that, in fact, I was not really in a supervised learning framework. So I will explain what I mean by supervised learning. So first, by quickly describing the mathematical framework, and then we will use it. So I have a classical couple with my matrix of covariates, X, and my output, Y, hemorrhagic shock or no hemorrhagic shock. In a supervised learning, your aim is to find a prediction function that minimizes the expected risk. The best possible prediction function is known as the Bayes rule, and its rate is known as the Bayes rate. So if we consider a squared loss L, or a 0-1 loss, it satisfies conditional expectation of Y given X. So in practice, we have access to a training data set, and consequently, a learner is obtained by minimizing the empirical risk. And we need to have a test set to estimate its error. So I will just use the words consistency in the sense of base consistency, in the usual sense, by saying that a procedure is base consistent if, given an infinite amount of data, it reaches the base rate. So what is different between all the classical literatures? So here, I explicitly consider the response variable, hemorrhagic shock or not hemorrhagic shock. So it means that my aim is not to estimate as well as possible my parameters beta and their variance from my incomplete data set, but my aim is really to predict as well as possible my output variables. In addition, I have two data sets with missing values, the training set and the test sets, and both have missing values. Because if you remember, I have two data generating processes, the one which generates the data and the missing value mechanism. So consequently, in a IID framework, we will have missing values in the train and in the test sets, otherwise it will be a distributional shift which can occur. So with student Nicolas Prost, Erwan Scornet, who is an assistant professor at École Polytechnique, and Gaël Varocco, a researcher in machine learning, we wrote a paper, and the aim of this paper, for the aim of this work, was to say, okay, is it possible to use previous approaches like the EM methods or imputation methods in this framework when your aim is to predict? Are these approaches consistent, or do we need to design a specific method? So we are going to see. So first, let's try with the EM. So I have my logistic regression model with the exponential of x beta divided by 1 plus exponential of x beta. Then, after my EM algorithm, I have estimation for the parameter. So I have beta 1, beta 2, hat, and so on. Now I have a test set which is incomplete. So I have a new observation, x n plus 1, and the second coordinate is missing. So you can see that it's not possible to directly use your logistic regression model because I can do beta hat 1 times the first one, but what can I do for the second coordinate because this is missing? But in fact, it turns out that the likelihood framework enables you to do prediction with missing values, although it has not been much discussed. So it's possible to do this simply by computing the probability of your outcome, Y, given the observed values. So I skip the details, but basically it boils down to performing a kind of multiple imputation where you will draw different plausible values for the missing entries from their predictive distribution, and then on each imputed data set, you will apply your logistic regression and aggregate the results, so to get the mean of the probabilities, and then you will take the max to predict hemorrhagic shock or not hemorrhagic shock. And with my co-author, we have proven that generalization of this approach can be consistent. So the message is okay, in fact, I can predict with missing values. This is possible. So with EM, this is possible. Done. Second part, with the imputation method, what can we do when we have training test set and we want to predict? So in fact, the most natural strategy and classical one will be the following one. So we have missing values in our training and our test set. So I will impute the training set with an imputation model. Then I will learn a model with the imputed training set and the Y train. On the test set, I will use the same imputation model and then use the same predictive model to get a prediction. So this is a quite classical and natural approach when you are used to do cross-validation methods. Okay? The problem of this approach is that we can see easily that it's easy to implement for univariate imputations. So if I impute the training set with the means of the training variables, then I can use the same means to impute the test set. This is perfectly okay. But often, we use other imputation methods. And many methods are black box methods, in the sense that they take as an input the incomplete data, and they output the completed data set. So it means that you do not have access explicitly to the explicit or implicit imputation models. So that's why many analysts in practice use separate imputation, where they impute the train and the test set separately. But this approach is suboptimal if you have a small test set of small sample size. And it's even impossible to use this strategy if I have only one observation to predict. So that's why other analysts used a semi-supervised approach, like group imputation, where you impute both the train and the test set simultaneously. But of course, the predictive model is learned only on the training imputed data set. But the problem is that sometimes at the test time, you do not have access necessarily to your training set. So what approach can we recommend? In fact, we can recommend the first one, which was the most natural one, because it turns out that even with mean imputation, this approach can be consistent for supervised learning. So we have a theorem that states this result explicitly under some assumptions. So the assumptions are that I have a regression model, like y equal of f of x plus epsilon. Then I suppose that my missing values are missing at random. So it means that they depend only on the observed values. Here, I have only missing values on one variable, but I can have missing values in all the variables. And then I will introduce two notations. So first, this quantity x prime, so it just means that here x prime 1 is equal to x1 when x1 is observed, and it is equal to the mean otherwise. The second notation that I need is just my data. My data, I denote the data like x tilde. So it is equal to x when x is observed and to not available when it's not available. So in fact, the data does not live in a vectorial space. It is a mix between continuous and categorical data. And the theorem states that if you predict on the mean imputed training data, this, then it is consistent in the sense that it targets conditional expectation of y given x tilde. So it targets the appropriate quantity. So the details can be found in the paper, but I will explain the rationale of the result. So the result is the following. So when you have missing values, you need to put a specific value which is systematic like a code for missing. Then your learner at the training time will detect this code, and consequently, if you use the same code, it will recognize it at the test time. So if we have categorical variable, you can just replace the missing entries with the code missing. But with continuous data, we do not know well how to handle a mix between continuous and categorical data. So that's why we can put any constant, so for instance, the mean. And the point which is important is that you need to have a super powerful learner that is able to learn anything, like any function. And in addition, you need to have a lot of data. This is an asymptotic result. But in fact, all of you are super learners because you are able to recognize that, okay, here the observed values and here something specific. And at the test time, you will recognize the same thing. So you will recognize that it was missing. So in fact, it's possible to use any constant and not necessarily the mean. And maybe this is better to use a constant which is out of range of the distribution. So it will be easier to recognize this constant. So the important point is to use the same constant to have a super powerful learner and a lot of data. So for me, this result is amazing, in fact, and very useful, because it justifies the practice of mean imputation that was used by many, and it justifies this, but just for prediction. So I insist, mean imputation is not bad for prediction. In fact, it is consistent, despite its drawback for estimation. So this can be useful when you want to predict. So I just want to say a few words about trees, just because to apply these results, I say that I need a super powerful learner. And the random forest, the extension of the trees, can be seen as a super powerful learner. In addition, at the beginning, I ask, OK, I want to know if I can use EM, if I can use imputation when my aim is to predict, or if I need to design a new strategy. And it turns out that the tree are very well suited for empirical risk minimization with missing values because of their ability to handle the half discrete nature of the data. So I will consider the classical classification and regression trees, which proceed by looking each time for a variable j, a threshold z, which minimizes the loss. So here I have two variables. So first, I will cut according to x1, then according to x2, and at the end, I have cells that are quite homogeneous. So when you have missing values, in fact, all the packages, a lot of packages, simply select the variable and the thresholds by deleting the observation with missing entries. So it selects, for instance, if x1 is the first variable which is selected, it will select the threshold s1 using only observation 1 and observation 4. But still, to build a tree, you need to have a method which propagates the observation with missing values, because otherwise it will lead to a drastic reduction of your data if you delete at each node all the missing values. So the most classical, the most simple approach consists in using probabilistic splits. So it means that I will send observation 2 and observation 3 to the left or to the right according to a Bernoulli distribution, using the proportion of points already on the left or already on the right. So in terms of minimization of the risk, and if I want to have a strategy which is the best one to predict my output given the fact that I have missing values, this is not optimal. And there is a far more better strategy, which is a bit well known and which is named as missing incorporated in attribute. So basically, this approach proceeds as follows. Instead of having two steps, like I first select the variable and the thresholds, and then I propagate the missing values, I will have only one step, where I will select the variable, the threshold, and propagate the missing values in one step. So each time, for each node, I have three strategies. Either I cut according to the variable j to the threshold z, and send the missing values to the right, or I cut according to the variable j, threshold z, and send two missing values to the left, or I cut according to missing, non-missing. So you can see that missing values are treated like a category, in a way. So it's well to handle the nature of our data, where we have continuous and categorical data. It is also good if the missing value is informative, because if your indicator of missing is an explanatory variable to your outcome. And in terms of implementation, it's very easy to implement this strategy. And in addition, it targets the quantity of interest, which is a conditional expectation of y given x tilde. So if I have to do any trees with missing values, if my aim is to predict, I will favor definitely this strategy. So I will skip the simulations, but I want to show you the sample complexity of the results, because I have said that this is an asymptotic result. So the point is that here I increase the sample size so from 1,000 to 1 million. In orange, I have mean imputation, and in red, I have an imputation with mice, a Gaussian imputation. So the point is that the approach is consistent because it reaches this base rate, which is in purple. This is the error of prediction. But when you have a sample size of, for instance, 1,000, maybe another imputation method rather than the mean can give you better prediction. Okay? So the sample complexity is this one. So to wrap up, so I know that there are many messages, but the point was to give you an overview of the topic. So I will just give you a few messages to keep and to take home. So on the first part, my important point is to say that single imputations aims at completing the data, and multiple imputation is appropriate if you want to estimate the parameters and their variance from the incomplete data set. I really like this sentence, like idea of imputation is seductive and dangerous. I trust this. For the second part, my take-home message is that, okay, single mean imputation can be consistent when you want to predict, given the fact that you have a powerful learner. And if you have trees, this missing incorporating attribute is an appropriate solution. So because I have only 2 minutes, I want to show you that this is, of course, an active area of research. There are many exciting research topics. So I invite all the people to work on missing values. Each time the doctors and the physicians ask me a question, oh, I want to do this analysis, I do not have a straightforward answer. So I need to develop the methods to deal with missing values. So there are many things to do. My important point is that in terms of resources, we have created a website, Hermistatic, with Imke Meyer, a PhD student, Nicola Tierney, and Nathalie Villanex. So this platform aims at being a reference platform on the theme of missing data management. It was funded by the R Consortium, and the aim of this platform is to list existing packages. So we have the task view, to put all the available literature, all the tutorials, to have analysis workflows on data, to put also all the main actors, to federate the community. But my main point with this is really to give the users who have missing values a key to enter in the field and to know what to do. Okay, what to do if I want to do a regression, what to do if I want to do a clustering, and so on. So I am really amazed because we managed, we started to federate the community. So we have many contributors. I put the links of amazing lectures and amazing tutorials as well. We have also a lot of things that I do not cover, like how to do when I have longitudinal data, time series, imputation, and Stefan Moritz, who is in the room, is an active contributor of the platform as well. So I would like to thank you warmly, invite you to go and contribute to this Hermistatic website. And this is just something that I have seen, and I think I need to use it for my next talks. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Julie. So we have some questions on Slido, and I try to order them. So we have had some questions, the famous questions about the... So first of all, I have to just swear I never, ever imputed by the mean. We have some questions about the proportion of missing values. Maybe we could quickly address them. Are there suitable imputation methods for a categorical variable with over 50% missing values?
Okay.
Or, later on, could you address this first question before we address the...
Sure. So for categorical variables with 50% of missing values, the answer is the same. So even though I have 50% of missing values, what is important is to see the variability. So I can handle 50% of missing values. It depends on the structure of my data. For categorical data, this is true that there are less far methods which are available, so which makes sense because there are less models for categorical data. But, for instance, yes, there are methods which are based on SVD-based methods for categorical data, nearest neighbor imputations, and so on. So there exist methods for categorical data.
The other questions were on assessing the imputed data. If one runs different missing value strategy, what would be your advice to compare the results and pick the best one for your problem? How to assess imputed data here? Do you have any recommendations?
Yes. So it's the same point. It depends on your aim. If your aim is to impute as well as possible, in fact, you can use cross-validation strategies. So where you will remove cells from your data set, you will predict with the imputation method A, imputation method B, and then you will select the imputation methods which gives you the best possible prediction. When your aim is to estimate parameters, this is a bit more difficult because you, with simulations, you can do this, of course, because you can compare the coverage of the parameters. And with a real data set, you need to take into account the properties of your imputation methods, and you will compare basically the variability and the confidence interval of the different methods.
And then we have two questions. One is on keeping track of the changes. So is it important to keep track of which values have been imputed for your analysis in case these are skewing your result? If yes, how to do that? And another question would be, the logistic on what to do when you have missing. I can't
missing
find
note
it.
On maybe.
Yeah, how do you suggest handling the logistical challenges of sharing data set with missing data? So, and the raw data with missing data and the one that have been imputed with multiple imputation, for example. How do you address this?
The logistical challenges.
Yeah.
This
how
is
to, how to keep track of the changes and the imputations.
So this is maybe one important challenge for multiple imputation in the area of big data, kind of. So we have already a lot of data, then you have missing values, and you will produce different imputed data sets. So what to do with this from a logistical point of view, this is still an ongoing question,
and
I will say.
How to keep track of them?
You can keep your multiple imputation table. So this you can keep them. So this is yes. Missing a
this one. Sometimes missing values also have a meaning.
Yes.
So why not treat the missing values as a separate category, as a whole variable?
Sure. For when you have categorical variables with missing values, really coding the missing values as a specific category is the best thing that you can do because it has a specific meaning, so you code it as a new category. So this is really the thing that that you can do and that allows you to keep track of this information. When it's missing at random, which is a bit related, so this is a kind of tough case of missing data. So it's informative missing values. So there are strategies that basically consist in specifying a model to model the missing value mechanism, but it's complicated for the inference. But for me, missing at random data, I have a lot of missing at random data in my trauma-based data. And that's one area of research I am really excited about. And I think that there are a lot of ideas that come from the causal discovery literature. And there are recent papers, especially one of Pearl, who for me is, offer new ideas to tackle this missing non-at-random data. So there are some work that are going to be released, and we managed to do things with missing non-at-random data. So this is not impossible.
We have a couple of minutes again. Other questions were related to our packages and where to find help, but you address these questions.
Yes, maybe I can show you quickly the platform. So we have all the packages, and then you can find the task view. So in the task view, we have organized all the packages by different themes: single imputation, multiple imputations, specific types of data, and so on. So in the platform, you can find this lecture, this general tutorials. So this is one which is beautiful, about mice, for instance. So we have tried to organize it as well as possible. So this can be, this is a beautiful, beautiful tutorials on mice. C'est magnifique. Think.
We have one technical question on, I think the two first one were already addressed, but do you look at the shape of the ellipses you're using P3 and beyond, principal components and beyond, and does variance explained by the two first principal components matter?
So here I just project the points to visualize their position, with different imputed values. So in fact, if with your data, the other components are important, yes, of course, you can have a look at other components as well, and not only the first one.
And the last one, because it's time, because I love this one, why people are developing methods that don't handle missing value in the first place?
Yes, this is I love this one as well, because for me it's amazing that really each time when I have data all the time, missing values all the time, and there are so many things that are not available with the missing values, but the point is that it's not necessarily straightforward, because if you want to do it with the EM, it's not so easy and so on, so there are a lot of things that I have hidden in a way, so it's not so easy, but yes. Even if you want to do variable selection in high dimension with missing values, this is not implemented, less who is missing value neither, and so on. So a lot of things to do.
So this session is over. Thank you very much. Thank you, Julie, and thank you, the organizing committee.